video, we're going to take a look at assessment of the heart and great vessels. Now, when I say great vessels, I'm talking about the carotid arteries, the jugular veins, and the aorta, so the bigger vessels. Now, as always, our assessment starts with inspection. But before we do a physical assessment, we need to ask a few questions. We want to make sure that we ask our patient if they're experiencing any chest pain or tightness or palpitations and get detailed information about that before we start, because that's really important. So to start the physical assessment, start by facing your patient. We're going to start with the bed at 30 to 45 degrees and start with the great vessels in the neck and work our way down. First, make sure that you look at both sides of their neck with a pen light for any jugular venous distension. If you see any pulsation, it should actually decrease and the vein should flatten as you sit the patient up. If you see any distension, even after they sit up, it could be a sign of heart failure. Next, you're going to palpate your patient's carotid arteries. You'll find it by sliding two fingers laterally from the thyroid gland. Should be strong and regular. Make sure you only palpate one side at a time, or you could cause too much vagal nerve stimulation and your patient will pass out on you. Next, we're going to move down to the anterior chest. You want to be able to see their chest, so you'll need to remove their gown. For a woman, if they don't have a bra or tank top on, you can expose one side at a time or simply lift and adjust their gown to maintain their privacy. Inspect the anterior chest for signs of pulsation. It's possible that you could see the apical pulse, but we also want to palpate that spot, which is the fifth intercostal space left midclavicular line. We're palpating for the point of maximum impulse, or PMI. This is the point at which the pulse feels the strongest. You also want to inspect and palpate for any pulsations in the abdomen that could indicate an abdominal aortic aneurysm. Now that you've inspected and palpated, we can move on to auscultation. Using the diaphragm of your stethoscope, you're going to listen using the ape to man mnemonic. You should hear an S1 and S2 sound at each location. A, aortic, second intercostal space, right sternal border. P, pulmonic, second intercostal space, left sternal border. E, Erb's point, third intercostal space, left sternal border. T, tricuspid, fourth intercostal space, left sternal border, and then M, mitral, fifth intercostal space, left midclavicular line. Now, while you're in the mitral location, go ahead and listen for a full minute to count the patient's apical pulse. Now, the reason that this is beneficial is especially for patients with abnormal heart rhythms like atrial fibrillation. If we have an irregular rhythm and we count for 15 seconds and multiply by 4, it may not actually be accurate because they've got longer pauses or shorter pauses. So we want to listen for a full minute to get an accurate number. Now you can turn around and use the bell of your stethoscope to listen back to the same 5 locations. As you do this, you're listening for murmurs and extra heart sounds like an S3 or S4. If you do hear something abnormal, make note of what location you heard it at, the timing, and the quality of the sound. Now, while you have the bell of your stethoscope on, you can cover your patient and return to their neck to listen over their carotid arteries for a brewy, which is like a whooshing sound that may indicate narrowing of the carotid arteries, which is never a good sign. Again, one side at a time. So that's it for assessment of the heart and great vessels. Any abnormalities should be reported to the provider right away, especially if they're new findings. Make sure you also check out the peripheral vascular assessment to learn how to assess the rest of the circulatory system. All right, guys, go out and be your best selves today. And as always, happy nursing.